Recorded Books Inspirational presents an unabridged recording of A Surrendered Heart by Tracie Peterson and Judith Miller, narrated by Barbara McCulloh and directed by Dave Millen. This book is copyrighted 2009 by Tracie Peterson and Judith Miller. This recording is copyrighted 2009 by Recorded Books, producer and publisher of Recorded Books Inspirational, an imprint dedicated to stories of faith and the human spirit. And now, A Surrendered Heart.
Chapter 1. Wednesday, April 26th, 1899, Rochester, New York. Cholera on the rise. Epidemic anticipated in Rochester. Amanda Broadmoor glanced at the imprudent headline that emblazoned last night's edition of the Rochester Democrat and Chronicle. Why must the newspaper exaggerate? People would be frightened into a genuine panic with such ill-advised news reporting. Turning the headline to the inside, she creased the paper and slipped it beneath a stack of mail on the marble-topped table in the lower hallway of her family's fashionable home. Certain this most recent newspaper article would cause yet another family squabble, she had hidden the paper in her bedroom the previous evening. No doubt the glaring headline had increased sales for the owner of the press. The paper had been quick to report 4 recent deaths attributed to the dreaded disease, and with an early spring and unrelenting rains, a number of prominent families had already fled the city. After yesterday's report, more would surely follow. And for those who didn't possess the wherewithal to flee, the report would serve no purpose but to heighten their fear. Of course, the Broadmoors were among the social elite of Rochester, New York. Amanda had never known need or want, and when bad things dared to rear their ugly heads, she had been carefully sheltered from the worst of it. All that had changed, however, when she decided to seek a career in medicine. At 21, Amanda felt she had the right to make her own way in life, but her father and mother hardly saw it that way. Their attitudes reflected those of their peers and the world around them. Women working in the medical field were highly frowned upon, and a woman of Amanda's social standing was reared to marry and produce heirs, not to tend the sick, especially not those suffering from cholera. And Mama can be such an alarmist. At the first report, Amanda's mother had suggested the entire family take refuge at their summer estate located on Broadmoor Island in the St. Lawrence River. But that idea had been immediately vetoed by her father. Jonas Broadmoor had avowed his work would not permit him to leave Rochester. And Amanda agreed with her father's decision. After devoting much of her time and energy to medical training at Dr. Carstead's side, Amanda couldn't possibly desert her work. Not now. Not when she was most needed. Amanda glanced at the clock. Her mother would expect her for breakfast, but remaining any longer would simply ensure a tearful plea for her to cease working with Dr. Carstead. She would then need to offer a lengthy explanation as to why her work was critical, and that, in turn, would cause a tardy arrival at the home for the friendless. Before the matter could be resolved, much valuable time would be wasted, time that could be used to care for those in need of her ministrations. With each newspaper claim, an argument ensued, leaving Amanda to feel she must betray either her mother or Dr. Carstead. She didn't feel up to a quarrel today. After fastening her cloak, she tucked a strand of blonde hair beneath her bonnet and slipped into the kitchen, where the carriage driver was finishing his morning repast. "Do hurry," she said, motioning toward the door. "I'm needed at the home." He downed a final gulp of coffee, wiped his mouth with the back of his hand, and nodded. "The carriage is ready and waiting." He quick-stepped to the east side of the kitchen and opened the door with a flourish. His broad smile revealed a row of uneven teeth. You see, always prepared. That's my motto. An excellent motto, though sometimes difficult to achieve, Amanda said, pleased to discover the rain had ceased. She hurried toward the carriage, the driver close on her heels. Her own attempts to be prepared seemed to fall short far too often. Since beginning her study of medicine with Dr. Carstead, she'd made every effort to anticipate his needs, but it seemed he frequently requested an item she'd never before heard of, a medical instrument other than what she offered, or a bandage of a different width. Amanda was certain her inadequate choices sometimes annoyed him. However, he held his temper in check, at least most of the time. Did you read today's headline? The driver asked before closing the carriage door. Amanda nodded. Indeed, that's why we must hurry. I'm afraid there will be many at the clinic doors this morning. Sometimes, simply hearing about an illness causes people to fear they've contracted it. A sense of exhaustion washed over her just thinking about the work ahead. The driver grimaced. I know what you mean, miss. I read the article in the paper and then wondered if I was suffering some of the symptoms myself. Have you been having difficulty with your digestive organs? At the mention of his digestive organs, the color heightened in the driver's cheeks. He glanced away and shook his head. No, but I had a bit of a headache yesterday and thought I was a bit thirstier than usual. It's likely nothing, but if you begin to experience additional symptoms, be sure to come and see the doctor. Don't wait too long. Still unable to meet her gaze, he touched his finger to the brim of his hat. Thank you for your concern, miss. I'll heed your advice. When they arrived at the home for the friendless, a short time later, Amanda's prediction proved true. Lines had formed outside the building, and there was little doubt most of those waiting were seeking medical attention. After bidding the driver good day, she hurried around the side of the building and entered through the back door, leading into the office Dr. Blake Carstead occupied during his days at the home. She stopped short at the sight of the doctor examining a young woman. You've arrived earlier than usual, I see. He grunted. After reading last night's newspaper, I knew we'd have more patients today. I wish someone would place a muzzle on that reporter. He seems to take delight in frightening people. Did you read what he said? Amanda removed her cloak and hung it on the peg alongside the doctor's woolen overcoat. Only the headline, she replied. I do hope the article was incorrect. Dr. Carstead continued to examine a cut on his patient's arm. It was exaggerated. There was one death due to cholera, but a colleague tells me the other deaths occurred when a carriage overturned and crushed two passers-by. I don't know why the owner of that paper permits such slipshod reporting. If I practiced medicine, the way that newspaper reports the news, I'd have a room filled with dead patients. The patient's eyes widened at the doctor's last remark. He truly does a better job than the newspaper, Amanda said, approaching the woman's side. Once the woman's arm had been properly bandaged, Amanda showed her to the door and returned to see how she could best assist Blake that day. Honestly, I think the newspaper enjoys putting people in a state of panic, Blake said as he washed his hands. Trouble sells papers. Amanda held out a towel. Blake took it and looked at her oddly for a moment. You look pale. Are you sleeping and eating right? She put her hands on her hips. I might ask you the same thing. You haven't slept in days. I didn't know you were keeping track, he said, rather sarcastically. But I don't have the same privilege of going home to a comfortable meal and bed that you have. And whose fault is that? Amanda countered. You won't go home, and you won't let me stay, It wouldn't be proper. She huffed. It won't be proper when you collapse from exhaustion either. But I'm sure I'll think of something to tell the masses of sick people. Oh, we're very sorry, but the doctor is a prideful and arrogant man who believes himself immortal. Even God rested on the seventh day, Dr. Carstead. God wasn't dealing with cholera at the time, Blake replied, unmoved by her comments. Amanda let out an exasperated breath and went to wipe down the examination table. It was their last opportunity for private banter, as a steady stream of patients kept them working until well past six that evening. Exhausted, but unwilling to let on how tired she was, Amanda reached for her coat and suppressed a yawn. How are you getting home? Blake asked. I'm certain the driver is waiting for me. I'll walk you out and make sure he's there. Amanda didn't argue. She wanted to ask when he planned to leave, but knew it would only stir an argument. She had no energy left to partake of such a silly exchange, and Blake seemed to sense this. Taking hold of her arm, he escorted her out to the street, where the Broadmoor carriage waited. The driver quickly climbed down and opened the door. His coat revealed that it had been raining much of the time he'd been waiting. Try to eat a good meal and take a hot bath, Blake instructed, as he helped her into the carriage. You're no good to me if you get sick. Amanda shook her head and fixed him with a stare. I was thinking much the same about you. Besides, you stink and need a shave. He looked at her soberly for a moment and then broke into a smile. There you go again, caring about me. She reached for the door. I'm not at all concerned about you, Dr. Carstead, but the friendless and sick are beginning to take up a collection for you. I believe they plan to purchase a bar of soap and a razor. Amanda pulled the door shut, even as she heard Blake roar with laughter. She smiled to herself. It was good to hear him laugh. There had been so little worth laughing about these last days. Thursday, April 27th, 1899. You're late, Blake growled out as Amanda entered the examination room the next day. I know I told you to rest, but I didn't mean all night and all day. Oh, hush. I'm only a few minutes late. The driver was delayed this morning. She hung up her coat and immediately pulled on her apron. She gave Blake a cursory glance. I see you took my advice. Now at least you won't drive people away in fear. Blake touched his clean-shaven chin before pointing to the door. The Rochester Health Board has sent examiners to check us out. I didn't want to look shabby for them. Amanda dropped to a nearby chair. She gasped as a fleeting pain sliced through her midsection. Once again, she had hurried out of the house without breakfast, in order to avoid a confrontation with her mother. This time, however, she was certain that had she eaten breakfast, she would have embarrassed herself in front of the good doctor. She swallowed and clasped her open palm tight against her waist. Has there been any further word regarding the quarantine? Dr. Carstead nodded toward the crowd gathered outside his door and touched a finger to his pursed lips. We don't want to cause undue worry. He leaned forward, his dark hazel eyes radiating concern. You're not getting sick on me, are you? No, of course not. I experienced a brief moment of discomfort, but I'm feeling fine. She stood and brushed a wrinkle from her faded navy blue skirt. Shortly after beginning her work with Dr. Carstead, she'd acquired a uniform of sorts. The doctor had been quick to advise that if she was serious about learning medicine, she'd best save her expensive silk and satin day dresses for leisure and adopt a more utilitarian form of dress for her days at the clinic. At first, she'd been affronted by his remark, but he'd been correct. Even though she had covered her serge skirts and cotton blouses with a canvas apron, the Broadmoor laundress still complained of the stains that required extra scrubbing. I'm sure we'll hear of the examiner's decision soon. Why don't you go through the line and separate those who have complaints that suggest they've contracted cholera? Place them in the office at the end of the hallway. When you've completed that, let me know, and I'll examine them. Amanda retrieved a pencil and paper. She preferred keeping notes while she spoke to the patients, especially when there were so many. Otherwise, important details could easily be forgotten. Before exiting the room, Amanda poured a glass of water and quickly downed the contents. The cool liquid slid down her parched throat, but her stomach immediately clenched in a painful spasm. Perhaps she should have eaten breakfast after all. Forcing a smile, she replaced the glass and hurried out of the room, with her stomach still violently protesting. Dr. Carstead waved another patient into his office, and Amanda stopped beside the next person in line. Although the older man appeared disgruntled when she approached, he finally complied when she advised him that he couldn't see the doctor unless he'd answered her questions. A brief look at the lump on his head and a view of his scraped knuckles confirmed that today's visit had nothing to do with cholera. After spending too much time at the local tavern last night, he'd challenged another patron to a fight. Amanda managed to maintain her composure for a while longer, but stopped short when she came to the sixth person in the long line. Clutching her stomach, she pointed her finger toward the ceiling. "I'll be back," she promised, then dropped her pencil and paper on a nearby table. Grabbing an enamel basin, she raced into a room at the far end of the hall and divested herself of the water she'd swallowed only minutes earlier. The liquid burned the back of her throat, and her stomach muscles ached in protest. But that was soon forgotten when gripping pains attacked her lower intestines. The intensity sent her running for the bathroom. When she returned a short time later, Dr. Carstead was waiting. "You're sick. You're as white as a sheet and shaking. Why didn't you tell me earlier? You may have infected all those you came in contact with today." Amanda clutched her stomach. "You think I have cholera?" She shook her head in denial. "I failed to eat breakfast, and my stomach is upset. Nothing more." Another spasm gripped her midsection and her knees buckled. Had Blake not held her upright, she would have collapsed at his feet. Blake Carstead stared at Amanda's pale face while he tucked a heavy blanket over her quivering body. He raked his long fingers through his unruly mass of dark brown hair and turned toward the door. How could he possibly manage without Amanda's help? The crowd continued to increase by the minute. "Quincy, I need your help," Blake shouted to Amanda's uncle, the proprietor of the home for the friendless. If Amanda contracted cholera, her parents would hold him responsible. Neither had encouraged her to pursue medical training. In fact, her father had used every ruse possible to keep her out of medical school. When Blake had suggested she could work with him and receive training, she'd readily accepted. Amanda stirred and touched his arm. "Water. I'm so thirsty," she whispered. He offered her only a couple ounces, for he knew what would occur. She clutched the glass and downed the small amount of liquid he offered. Immediately, she pointed to the nearby basin. Fear shone in her eyes as she heaved relentlessly before falling back onto the bed. Where was Quincy? He rushed to the door and peered into the clamoring crowd of patients. All of them wanted to see a doctor, and none of them wanted to wait in the overflowing room. They all feared the same thing, the person sitting beside them might carry the dreaded disease. When he finally spotted Quincy, he stepped farther into the room and shouted above the din. Two men, neither one appearing particularly happy, stood inside the front entrance. Blake recognized them as officials from the health department. They shook their heads, obviously agitated and anxious to be on their way. They pushed a paper into Quincy's hand and hurried from the room. After Quincy read the paper, he shoved it into his jacket and then cupped his hands to his mouth. "The home for the friendless has been placed under quarantine. The authorities have tacked a formal notice to the front gate." A hum of dissent quickly escalated into angry voices. Quincy retrieved the wrinkled sheet of paper from his pocket and waved it overhead. "This is a letter of explanation. No one is to leave the building." Blake wasn't surprised when the gathered patients rushed out of the waiting room and onto the streets. They looked like mice fleeing a sinking ship, and there was no one to stop them. Within minutes, few remained, and those who did were too infirm to leave under their own power. By the terms of the quarantine, no one should have left the building, but neither Blake nor Quincy possessed the power to hold them prisoner, and the authorities didn't have sufficient time to enforce the orders. They were too busy delivering them. The behavior of the patients came as no surprise to Dr. Carstead. He'd seen the same reaction in other cities. People understood the need for quarantines, but they refused to be inconvenienced. He'd discovered many were willing to remain within the confines of their own homes, but they didn't want to be held in an unfamiliar institution, such as the home for the friendless. And he understood their behavior. He, too, would have preferred to be surrounded by the comfort and convenience of his own home, where the downstairs had been converted into a doctor's office, with all of the latest equipment to provide care for patients able to afford his medical services. Recently, Blake's volunteer work at the home was consuming more and more of his time. There was little doubt he would be needed here during the days to come. The living conditions of those who required free medical care made them all the more susceptible to diseases. Besides, there were sufficient doctors within the city of Rochester to care for those patients who could afford to pay for medical treatment. According to the terms of the notice, they would be quarantined at the home for the next 5 days. Further evaluation would be made at that time. And with several patients showing definite signs of cholera, Blake guessed the quarantine would be extended. If they were to stave off the spread of the disease, it would take more than quarantines. He lifted his gaze upward. "We need you, Lord," he whispered, before finally gaining Quincy's attention. When the older man drew near, Blake grasped him by the arm and pulled him closer. "It's Amanda. I'm afraid she's suffering from cholera." Quincy peered across the threshold. The sight of his niece caused him to pale. "I greeted her when she arrived this morning. She looked fine. When did this... How could this..." "Her parents will never forgive me. They'll blame this on me." "They can't possibly blame you. They..." Quincy shook his head with a vehemence that caused his hair to settle in unfashionable disarray. "You mark my words. If Amanda doesn't recover, I'll face my brother's wrath for the remainder of my days. Jonas Broadmoor can hold a grudge longer than any man I've ever known." Both of the men turned when Amanda stirred. "My stomach. I need help," she groaned. Blake tightened his hold on Quincy's arm. "We must locate a woman to help her. She'll be in further distress if I attempt to assist her while she's in the throes of elimination." Quincy agreed. They had both assisted one of the men who'd gone through several days of suffering. The poor fellow had died soon thereafter. The episode was an immediate reminder of debilitating scenes of violent vomiting, an unrelenting evacuation of the bowels, accompanied by gripping pain and spasms that left the victim dehydrated. Nothing good could be said of what lay in store for Amanda. Blake would oversee her care, but he didn't want to cause her embarrassment. She had been surrounded by wealth all her life. Now she'd be subjected to suffering this terrible illness in pitiable conditions. And all because of him. He should have insisted that she remain at home when the first cases of cholera had been suspected. Instead, he'd encouraged her to continue working alongside him. He'd told himself he was furthering her medical career, while in truth, he'd both wanted and needed the caring hands she offered. Only now did he acknowledge his motivation had been born of selfishness. What had he done? While Quincy hurried off in search of some willing soul who might lend aid, Blake dragged a wooden screen from across the room and placed it beside Amanda's bed. It would offer a modicum of privacy. She moaned, and her eyes fluttered open.
Water. Please, won't you give me water?
The result would be the same, but he couldn't refuse. He placed a basin on the table and then poured her a drink. She'd barely finished drinking when she retched and emptied the contents of her stomach into the basin. Blake brushed the damp strands of hair from her perspiring forehead. Surely she must have had some of these symptoms before she'd come to work this morning. Why hadn't she stayed home, where she could be properly cared for? Before he could ask, Quincy peeked around the screen. Mrs. Donner has offered to lend a hand.
But only for a price, the woman said.
She tapped her index finger in the opposing palm.
Don't forget, you promised to pay me in advance.
Blake met the woman's intense gaze.
You might consider helping for the sake of simply doing good for another, Mrs. Donner.
Don't you go judging me, Dr. Carstead. If I die from cholera, Miss Broadmoor's father won't take it upon himself to feed my children. I learned a long time ago that God helps them that help themselves. If I recall, you and your children have been living in the Home for the Friendless, free of charge, for well over 3 months now. Aren't those beds and food worth a speck of charity from you? When she shrugged, her tattered shawl slipped from one shoulder, and she yanked it back into place. You'll not convince me to change my mind. Do you want my help or not?
She turned to face Quincy.
We want your help.
Blake motioned to a pitcher and water. You'll need to be careful to wash your hands after you've had contact with Miss Broadmoor. He glanced at the woman's dirt-encrusted fingers. In fact, I had best teach you the proper method for scrubbing before you begin your new duties.
Soon as I get my money, she said.
Quincy offered an apologetic look.
She's the only one who would even consider coming back here.
Blake removed several coins from his pocket and placed them in the woman's outstretched hand. This will have to do for now. We have no way of withdrawing money from the bank. The quarantine, you know. Her hand remained open.
I'm guessing Mr. Broadmoor can offer a little more.
Quincy withdrew two bills from his pocket and gave them to her. The older woman grinned and tucked them into her pocket along with the coins.
Now, let's have that lesson in hand washing.
While Blake led Mrs. Donner to the wash basin,
Quincy followed along, reciting scripture. "And above all these things, put on charity, which is the bond of perfectness." Mrs. Donner squared her shoulders and pointed her finger in Quincy's direction.
"I don't need you reciting passages about charity. It's easy to be charitable when you got food on your table and money in the bank."
Anger flashed in the woman's eyes.
"If you want my help, you'll pay me with money and keep your preaching for them that want to hear it."
Blake sent a warning look in Quincy's direction. If he was left to care for Amanda through this undignified illness, she'd never be able to look him in the eye. He didn't want Mrs. Donner to leave him stranded in such a circumstance.
Chapter 2. With a mixture of irritation and surprise, Jonas Broadmoor waved Victoria into his office. He was certain his wife had advised him she would be remaining at home all day today. Now here she was distracting him before it was even mid-morning. After all these years, Victoria still didn't seem to realize that the business day was exactly that, a time set aside to complete meaningful tasks without interruption. He dipped his pen into the ink bottle and continued writing in the ledger. "What brings you to the office, Victoria?" A brief glance was enough for him to place the pen in the bronze holder. She was positively pale. "Has something happened?" Victoria placed her handkerchief to her lips and nodded.
"They've quarantined the home for the friendless. I sent my maid to pick up that new gown I ordered. The driver passed by the home, and Veda saw the quarantine sign. She told me they aren't letting anyone in or out of the place."
Jonas shrugged. "I doubt Quincy will be overly inconvenienced. He's at the home all the time as it is." Victoria straightened in her chair and slapped her palm on his desk.
"Your daughter is there, Jonas. Our Amanda is going to be quarantined for 5 days with those diseased people. Don't you realize what that means?"
Jonas leaned back in his chair. "How does this change anything? I told you months ago I didn't approve of her training with Dr. Carstead. You're the one who agreed with this medical nonsense. You encouraged her when she said she wanted to become a nurse."
"Doctor," Victoria corrected.
Jonas jerked to attention.
"What?"
"It isn't nursing that interests Amanda. She wants to become a doctor. There's a vast difference, Jonas."
"Oh, forevermore, Victoria. Why are we quibbling over minute details? Doctor, nurse.
It makes little difference. Your decision has subjected Amanda to cholera."
"You know I did everything in my power to stop her from going back to the home until after the outbreak subsided. If we'd gone to the island as I suggested, she would be safe from harm. Our remaining in Rochester was your doing."
She glared across the desk.
"And now you dare accuse me of subjecting our daughter to a deadly disease? I'm almost sorry I came here."
"Almost, but not quite. Correct?" He arched his brows. They were playing a game of cat and mouse, and he didn't intend to lose. "You expect me to find some way to get her out of that place. That's why you've come here, isn't it?"
Victoria tightened her lips into a thin line and offered only a slight tip of her head. The unanticipated ease of her admission lessened Jonas's thrill of victory. He determined she must be extremely worried, and very likely he should be too. One of his children had placed herself in danger. He should have insisted that Amanda give up this notion of becoming a doctor.
Once he rescued her from his brother's home for the friendless, there would be no further discussion. Adult or not, Amanda was going to abide by his rules until she married. And his rules would include the termination of any further medical training with Dr. Carstead. He closed the ledger and pushed away from his desk. Before going to the other end of town, let's stop by the house. I do hope Amanda has used her good sense and managed to sneak out after the authorities departed. They're far too busy to guard every home bearing a quarantine notice. And it would be easy enough for her to leave by a back door.
Jonas, I can't believe you would say such a thing. Those quarantines are in place to help prevent the spread of disease. And Amanda would not ignore such an order.
She has no difficulty ignoring my orders. He shrugged into his black wool topcoat and gathered his hat and cane. Take us home, he instructed their driver as they exited his office. Victoria didn't argue, and for that, he was thankful. This had been a day he'd set aside to work on his ledgers, and thus far, he'd found nothing encouraging in the numbers. His losses appeared even greater than he'd first imagined. The thought was enough to cause perspiration to bead along his forehead, in spite of the chilly April breeze. He settled into the thick leather cushion and withdrew his handkerchief from his pocket. Victoria leaned aside as he swiped his forehead.
Jonas, you're ill. Why didn't you tell me?
He detected the fear in her eyes. I don't have cholera, Victoria. She removed a glove and touched her palm to his forehead.
You feel clammy. That's not a good sign. I've been questioning Amanda regarding the symptoms.
Jonas lightly grasped her hand and lifted it from his forehead. Please, trust me. I am fine. While keeping her gaze fastened upon him, Victoria worked her fingers back into her glove.
I think your decision to return home before going to check on Amanda is sound. I don't want you going anywhere else if you're ill.
He sighed. No need to argue further. His wife would not heed his words. He dropped back against the seat and stared out the window until the horses came to a halt in front of their East Avenue mansion.
You sit still, Jonas. I'll have the driver help you down.
Jonas yanked the handle and pushed open the carriage door. I am not ill, and I do not need assistance out of the carriage. Please stop this foolishness. He extended his hand to help her from inside. Her furtive glances didn't go unnoticed as they continued up the front steps leading into the house. He wished he'd left his handkerchief in his pocket.
Any word from our daughter?
Jonas inquired of the butler, who helped them with their coats. I don't believe so. But you have a visitor waiting in the library, Mr. Broadmoor. Victoria shot him a warning look.
Do tell whoever it is that we have important business requiring our immediate attention.
Jonas could feel the perspiration beginning to bead across his forehead again, yet he dared not wipe it away.
Please rest easy, my dear.
Nothing is going to change regarding the quarantine. We will go there in due time. Victoria grasped the sleeve of his jacket.
In due time? Amanda needs to be removed from that place as soon as possible. I want her home before nightfall.
Yes, my dear, and I will see to it that she is. Jonas glanced at the butler, who appeared as rigid and stoic as the statues that adorned their gardens. I assume you have the name of my visitor? With a curt nod, the butler retrieved a calling card from the silver tray and handed it to Jonas. He stared at the engraved block letters. Vincent Fillmore. The last thing he needed right now was a meeting with his lawyer's son and law partner. And why had Vincent come to the house rather than his office?
I won't be long,
he told his wife, before turning down the hallway. What else could possibly go wrong today? Wasn't it enough that he was suffering these severe financial woes? His stomach clenched into a knot. What if Vincent had come to deliver devastating news regarding a legal issue? Something that would send his finances plummeting even further. At the moment, he wondered why he'd even gotten out of bed this morning. The day had been filled with enough bad news for at least a month, and it wasn't yet noon. He opened the library door and motioned for Vincent to remain seated. What brings you to my home in the middle of the day? Without waiting for an answer, he dropped to the chair across from the younger man. Didn't you realize it's a weekday? Vincent raked his fingers through his hair. To be honest, I didn't think at all. My father died just a short time ago. Jonas gasped. Panic washed over him and seized a tight hold. His mouth went dry. Father told me I was to advise you immediately of his death, no matter when it occurred. Vincent slumped forward and shook his head. I knew this day would arrive, but he'd been feeling better over the past 2 weeks. So, it wasn't cholera? No. The doctor said his heart simply gave out. I had feared Father might contract cholera, but the doctor tells me the newspaper reports have been exaggerated. Is that so? My wife will be pleased to hear that. Jonas's thoughts whirred as he attempted to maintain his composure. I am genuinely sorry for your loss, Vincent. Your father was a dear friend and confidant. Thank you. He wanted you to say a few words at the gravesite. What? Me? Surely he hadn't heard Vincent correctly. I think a local preacher would be a better choice, don't you? I mean, it's just not proper. I wouldn't know what to say. Vincent laced his fingers together. Whatever you say will be fine. My father was never one to stand on ceremony. You know that better than anyone. He had no use for the church, and always thought he'd outwit God. He used to tell me he was going to live like the devil, and at the end, he'd ask forgiveness and step into heaven with a smile. Let's hope it works that way, Jonas replied. Their conversation was veering off in a strange direction. The last thing he wanted right now was a discussion of right and wrong, or of heaven and hell. All he wanted at the moment was to secure his files from Mortimer's office. He silently chastised himself. He should have transferred his papers to another lawyer long ago. He'd given consideration to the idea several times. Unfortunately, he'd never found anyone else he could trust, like he did Mortimer. The two of them had shared the same ideas about making money. There were no rules, as long as there was a profit to be made. He had no way of knowing how much of his business and personal information Mortimer had committed to writing. What if he'd maintained files that told of Jonas's business dealings? He couldn't risk anyone discovering such information. We must leave immediately and go to your father's office. Jonas pushed up from the chair without giving Vincent an opportunity to disagree. What's this? Victoria entered the room with her coat draping one arm and her hat perched atop her head. You're not planning on going somewhere other than the home for the friendless, are you? Jonas stepped forward. Mortimer passed on this morning. I believe Vincent needs me to assist him with several matters surrounding his father's death. Victoria hurried to Vincent's side and murmured her condolences. Exactly how can Jonas be of help at this moment? Jonas couldn't hear Vincent's muttered response, but from the hard-edged look in Victoria's eyes, Jonas knew his wife was unhappy. Mortimer died this morning? And you want to go and retrieve your business files? Jonas Broadmoor, I can't believe you would even think of such a thing when Vincent is overcome with grief and mourning the loss of his father. Victoria patted Vincent's arm. Do let me call for tea. Vincent shook his head. No, I really must be on my way. I have much to do. Jonas forced a smile. I'm sorry for my lack of tact, Vincent. However, I think you know your father would approve. He was an astute lawyer who always thought of business first. He needed to win Vincent over. Once the younger man departed, there would be little opportunity until after the funeral to retrieve his files. With family members sniffing about, any one of them might go through Mortimer's files. He didn't want to take that chance. I can have my driver take us to your father's office this very minute. It wouldn't take but a few moments of your time. The younger man's jaw went slack, and he shook his head. Not now, Jonas. I must see to the funeral arrangements. Vincent sidestepped around him and strode toward the library door. But I truly need those... What you need to do is show some decency and respect, Victoria hissed. There is nothing that won't keep until after Mortimer is buried. His wife brushed past him and hurried out of the room. Do keep us advised of the funeral arrangements. Jonas dropped into a nearby chair and massaged his forehead. The day had gone from bad to worse by the hour. Could anything else possibly go awry this day? If so, he couldn't imagine what it would be. Paul Medford kissed his daughter's cheek before his wife lifted her from his arms. Our Elizabeth is the loveliest little girl ever born. Sophie tucked the soft flannel blanket around her daughter's tiny body. I couldn't agree more, and she is very fortunate to have you as her papa. The words warmed him even more than the hearty breakfast Sophie had served him a short time ago. The fact that Wesley Hedrick had forsaken Sophie and his unborn child had proved to be a blessing for Paul. He daily thanked God for the opportunity to call Sophie his wife and claim Elizabeth as his child. He pushed away from the kitchen table, and Sophie accompanied him to the door. While he shoved his arms into his warm woolen coat, she retrieved his hat. No doubt this day would be busy, but he'd discovered deep satisfaction in his work at the Home for the Friendless. He lowered his head and kissed Sophie's lips. I'll be home as early as possible. Sophie didn't reply. Instead, she lifted on tiptoe and kissed him again. They both knew that he'd do his best, but likely wouldn't return until well after dark. The needs at the home increased daily, especially since the outbreak of cholera. It seemed that anyone having the slightest symptom came to see the doctor. Most simply wanted reassurance they hadn't contracted the disease. Others had genuine problems. A cut that required stitches, or a woman laboring to deliver a newborn. And then there were those looking for a safe place of shelter and a warm meal. Most thought God had no use for them, but Paul knew better, and he did his best to show them God's love through his actions. Unless asked, he didn't offer advice or sermonize to the strangers who came for help. In fact, he could quickly calculate the number of times he'd preached since receiving his divinity degree. Those who found shelter at the home were encouraged to attend a church of their choosing on Sunday mornings. Residents were sent out the front doors after breakfast and not permitted to return until after 12:30 on Sunday afternoon. Whether they actually attended church was between them and God. Sophie's father, Quincy, thought the residents should be permitted to worship in their own manner. He didn't want anyone to think they must adhere to specific religious beliefs in order to be welcomed into the home. Paul grinned at the thought. People flocked to their doors in overwhelming numbers, and he doubted any would depart if forced to attend a church service on the premises. Most would probably prefer such an arrangement. They wouldn't be required to go outdoors in the cold or rain. But Paul didn't argue with his father-in-law, nor did he look for another place to serve the Lord. For now, he believed God wanted him to serve at the home for the friendless. He shoved his hands into his gloves and reached for the doorknob.
"Why don't you invite Amanda and Dr. Carstead to join us for supper this evening?" Sophie suggested. "I see my dear cousin far too seldom. And I'm certain Elizabeth misses her Aunt Amanda, too."
"I'll do my best to convince them," he said. "There are so many patients that need their attention. I'm not..."
"Tell Amanda that I insist. They both need to take a little time for pleasure, and so do you. I'll expect all three of you no later than 6 o'clock.
"You're right. An evening of visiting and good food is just what the doctor ordered, even if the doctor doesn't know it." The sound of Sophie's laughter followed him down the front steps. As a harsh wind assailed him from the north, he tucked his head low. Paul believed the walk to work each morning helped him maintain his good health. However, he would have gladly exchanged his morning exercise for a ride in a warm carriage on this brisk morning. Though a cutting chill remained, the wind subsided as he rounded the final corner. He squinted against the sun. Not one soul stood waiting for admission to the home. Ever since the first frightening case of cholera had been detected, the medical office had been swarmed with daily visitors. And after the recent newspaper headlines, he'd expected an even larger crowd. He strode forward, but stopped short at the front gate. Quarantine. He didn't take time to read the fine print. The one word was enough to explain the absence of the usual morning arrivals. Paul cupped his hands to his mouth.
"Quincy! It's Paul! Can you hear me? Come to the door."
He waited a moment and then tried again. With the windows tightly closed and shuttered against the cold, his voice would never be heard. He glanced at the iron bell used to announce that meals were being served. Without a moment's hesitation, he entered the gate, pulled the worn rope, and waited. The shutters that covered one of the windows in the front of the house opened. Blake. So the doctor had been captured in the quarantine, too. Paul pointed to the front of the building.
"Open the door!"
Blake momentarily disappeared before the door opened and he stepped onto the porch.
"Didn't you read the notice? You can't come in here, Paul."
"I understand," he said, careful to keep some distance between them. "But what can I do to help?" Blake rubbed his hands together. "We'll need our food replenished in a couple days. And could you gather medical supplies? Ask John Phillips. He'll help you choose what I need." Paul had become acquainted with John Phillips when he'd first arrived in Rochester. The man operated a pharmacy nearby. "Anything else?" Blake stepped down from the porch and drew closer. "Tell Mr. and Mrs. Broadmoor that Amanda has contracted cholera. I'm doing my best for her. She's young and strong. But I can't say with certainty that she'll make it. She's very sick." Paul grasped the fence and steadied himself. The news would devastate Sophie. And what of Mr. and Mrs. Broadmoor? Amanda's parents would surely blame themselves for permitting her to work at the home. The thought of delivering this dreadful report left him speechless.
"Paul, did you hear me?"
Blake shouted.
Yes, I'll tell them.
Do you think I mean, should I?
Just tell them exactly what I've said. There's no way of knowing what will happen. If they want to speak to me, tell them to do as you have. Ring the bell and I'll come out. Paul nodded and turned, too dazed to ask any further questions.
Don't forget the medicine and food, Blake hollered.
Paul waved in recognition of the request. He couldn't find his voice. The possibility had always existed that one of them would contract some fatal disease from one of the patients. But Paul had always believed God's hand of protection was upon them. They were, after all, doing God's work. He rounded the corner and forced such thoughts from his mind. He'd speak to Sophie first. It would be best if she accompanied him to meet with Amanda's parents. Sophie knew them better than he. Perhaps she could lend some advice on how to best approach them. For the second time this day, he wished he hadn't walked to work. Chapter 3. Sophie tied the ribbons of Elizabeth's bonnet beneath the sleeping child's tiny chin while her husband paced in the hallway. Amanda had stitched the bonnet during one of the three cousins' many sewing sessions before Elizabeth's birth. Sophie pictured the three of them, Fanny, Amanda, and herself, sitting in the bedroom at Broadmoor Castle with their sewing baskets and fabric. A smile played at her lips as she remembered her cousin's efforts to improve her sewing skills. They'd been mostly unsuccessful. And Sophie had accepted the fact that she'd never be an accomplished seamstress, not like Amanda. She traced her finger along the embroidered stems of bluebells with pale green stems and veined leaves that adorned the cap. The love she held for her cousins was deeper than that which she held for her own siblings. Throughout the years, Amanda and Fanny had been her closest friends and confidants. Many had been the occasion when her own sisters had turned away from her in frustration or disgust, but not Amanda and Fanny. They might not always approve of the things she did, but they would never dream of deserting her. "How can I help?" Paul asked as he continued to pace. "I'll just be a moment longer. Is the carriage out front?" "Yes, we really must be on our way." Sophie turned and frowned at her husband. "I'm doing my best." She lifted Elizabeth from her cradle, careful to keep the blanket tucked tightly around the child. Some said the damp air could cause cholera, and she didn't intend to take her outdoors unless properly protected against the elements. "I want to make certain the baby is warm enough." "Yes, of course," he replied, shifting his gaze toward the floor. Her words carried a hint of censure, and Paul had taken note. Sophie immediately regretted her behavior. Paul was worried and needed her support instead of a reprimand. But she was worried too, about all of them. What if Paul or Elizabeth should fall ill? She couldn't bear the thought of losing either of them. "I'm sorry for speaking harshly," she said. Paul smiled and took the baby into his arms. "You're forgiven. We're both worried." He brushed her cheek with a kiss and opened the door. The carriage ride to her aunt and uncle's home seemed longer than usual, and Sophie fidgeted throughout the ride. Surprisingly, her movement had little effect upon Elizabeth, who continued to sleep. A short time later, Paul brought the carriage to a halt in front of her uncle's home, and Elizabeth's eyes popped open. She wriggled in Sophie's arms and whimpered.
"I know you like riding, but we must stop for a while," she cooed to the baby.
The butler answered the door and, with a nod, bid them enter. He attempted to remain proper,
but Sophie noticed his little smile at Elizabeth.
Are my aunt and uncle at home, Marvin?
The butler nodded.
I'll inform them that Mr. and Mrs. Medford and baby Elizabeth have come to call.
Thank you, Marvin. The man was a saint. No wonder her uncle paid him well.
Marvin is the one who helped Amanda, Fanny, and me set up a bucket of whitewash over the kitchen door.
Paul grinned.
I recall your telling me about that incident. I believe it was your Uncle Jonas who ended up covered in whitewash, rather than Amanda's brothers, Jefferson and George.
Sophie smiled, remembering the sight of her uncle doused in the white concoction. She didn't know who had been more surprised, but she did recall that her uncle's jacket and spectacles had both required a good deal of Marvin's fastidious attention. The entire incident had delighted Jefferson and George, who had promised they'd be on the lookout for any further antics from the three girls. How the years had changed their circumstances. Sophie missed the times when they would gather at Amanda's or at their grandparents' home to spend the night together. They would giggle and talk late into the night about all their hopes and dreams. Funny how life had taken so many unexpected turns. This was not anything like the dream Sophie once had for herself. Amanda and Fanny had always advised her to marry a wealthy man, for only a man of great resources could keep Sophie in the style she craved. Paul was anything but financially well off. Elizabeth wriggled in her arms and burst forth with a lusty cry as Marvin returned to the foyer.
Seems your little girl doesn't enjoy waiting. Must take after her mother, he said with a grin. Your aunt and uncle will see you in the library.
He leaned a bit closer.
They were preparing to depart on some business.
So they're not particularly happy that we've arrived, Sophie replied, while Elizabeth continued to cry.
I believe that would be correct.
Sophie lifted the baby to her shoulder and hoped she could quiet the child while they delivered the news. She glanced at Paul when they arrived at the library door.
I can't seem to quiet her. Perhaps you should go in and deliver the news while I wait out here with the baby.
No. He shook his head and clasped her elbow. They'll receive this better if you're along.
Sophie arched her brows. She didn't think her presence would soften the blow, but she didn't argue. Elizabeth released a high-pitched wail as they crossed the threshold and entered the library. Her uncle furrowed his brow and scowled in their direction.
She has just now awakened from her nap and is a bit fussy, Sophie explained.
Well, do something to pacify her.
Jonas pulled on his earlobe.
I can't tolerate that squealing. It's enough to shatter a mirror.
Sophie edged closer to Paul.
I think I should take Elizabeth to the other room.
We won't take but a few minutes of your time, sir.
Paul grasped Sophie's sleeve when she attempted to move toward the door. Sophie and I have the task of bringing you a piece of disheartening news. Before he could say anything more, the baby screeched, and Jonas jumped up from his chair.
Do something to make that child happy, Sophie. You are her mother. I would think you'd know how to stop that incessant crying.
I'm trying, she apologized, swaying back and forth and patting the baby's back. Jonas, the baby is likely suffering from colic. Your angry temperament is not going to do a jot of good. You've likely frightened the child even further.
Victoria extended her arms.
Let me try, Sophie.
Sophie willingly handed over the baby, though she doubted her aunt would have success. Elizabeth was like the little girl in Longfellow's poem. When she was good, she was very good indeed. But when she was bad, She was horrid. Though Elizabeth lacked the curl in the middle of her forehead, Sophie thought that too would appear over time. Jonas massaged his forehead. The three of you continue your visit. I have matters that require my attention. Before her uncle could reach the door, Paul stepped in front of her. You can't leave, sir. Jonas straightened his shoulders and extended his chest forward. What do you mean, I can't leave? How dare you tell me what I can or can't do in my own home? Step out of the way before I am forced to have you removed, young man. Paul directed a beseeching look at Sophie. Stepping to her husband's side, Sophie said, Listen to him, Uncle Jonas. This is very important, or we wouldn't have come here. The baby silenced her wailing, and the room became eerily quiet. Sophie sat down beside her aunt and peeked at Elizabeth. Perhaps she should take the child before Paul announced Amanda's illness. Her aunt could faint and drop the baby. Let me take her, Aunt Victoria. Jonas turned on his heel. Don't touch that child. She'll likely begin to squall if you move her. He shifted around toward Paul. Now, what is it that's so important? The home for the friendless has been placed under quarantine, and is that what this is about? We already know that. In fact, if the two of you hadn't interrupted us with your unexpected visit, we'd be on our way over there now. I plan to have Amanda sneak out the rear door and come home immediately. You can't do that, sir, Paul said. Don't preach to me about what I can and can't do. I'm not going to have my daughter remain in that place with all of those dirty, homeless people. They're probably all carriers of the disease. I'm going to bring her home. This doctor nonsense has gone far enough. Amanda is going to remain at home and conduct herself in a proper manner until I find a suitable husband for her. Sophie shook her head, and her uncle glared at her. You can't bring Amanda home because she has already contracted cholera, Uncle Jonas. That's what Paul has been trying to tell you. Her aunt's gasp was enough to alert Sophie, and she promptly lifted Elizabeth from the older woman's arms. Don't fret, Aunt Victoria. Blake will do everything possible for Amanda. She'll have constant care. He won't let her... She couldn't utter the word. Die? Jonas snorted. Dr. Carstead can't control life and death. Not where cholera is concerned. But God can, Paul said. We must be in constant prayer for Amanda and ask God to remove this plague from our city. Why pray? If God has already determined to let my daughter die, your prayers won't change a thing. The harsh words were meant as a rebuke, but Paul grasped her uncle's shoulder. You're wrong, Mr. Broadmoor. Prayer doesn't always yield the answer we desire, but God does hearken to our prayers. Consider Abraham and his pleas to save Sodom. If we expect God to help, we must communicate the desires of our heart. When her aunt slumped sideways and fell against Sophie's arm, Sophie placed Elizabeth on the settee. With her free hand, she motioned to her husband. Please ask Marvin to bring a damp cloth. Jonas tapped his wife's shoulder. If we're going to go and fetch Amanda, you'll need to muster your strength. This is no time for the faint of heart. Sophie thought Uncle Jonas an insensitive bore, but his words had the desired effect. Before Marvin arrived with a damp cloth, her aunt's color had returned, and under her own strength, she managed to return to an upright position. You're correct, Jonas. I'll get my hat. We must be on our way. She can't be released to your care, Paul insisted. From what Blake tells me, her condition is grave. Even if permitted, any attempt to move her would prove disastrous. Look at the weather. Would you bring her out in this damp air? Victoria stood and steadied herself for a moment before she crossed the room. Pushing aside the curtain, she peered out the window and then turned to her husband. Paul is correct, Jonas. We can't risk the possibility. Victoria withdrew a handkerchief from her pocket and blotted her eyes.
My dear Amanda, this is my fault. I encouraged her to seek a life of fulfillment. Don't blame yourself, Aunt Victoria. Amanda was determined to pursue a medical career. Even if she had remained at home, she might have contracted the disease.
I doubt that.
We're all perfectly fine.
'Tis true, Aunt Victoria. I'm told Mr. and Mrs. Warford's daughter Jane is one of the recent victims.
Victoria clasped a hand to her throat.
Jane? Oh, her dear mother and father must be distraught. When did you hear this news?
Only late last evening. You see, it makes little difference that you granted Amanda permission to work at the home for the friendless.
The home? I understand it's been placed under quarantine, Fanny said, bursting into the library. She glanced at Paul.
I'm relieved to see that you're not one of those required to remain there. I assume Uncle Quincy has been restricted.
She turned to her aunt.
What of Amanda? Where is she?
Sophie motioned to her cousin.
Come sit down beside me, Fanny.
In hushed tones, Sophie related the news of their cousin's illness.
We must go to her, Fanny said.
We've already had this discussion. No one is going to go there, Paul said. Prayer is the answer.
An hour later, Fanny and Sophie were the only ones who remained in the library. Paul had helped Jonas get Victoria to bed, hoping a brief nap would help her better cope with the situation, and then had taken Elizabeth for a walk around the house so that Sophie and Fanny might converse in private.
Do you suppose Amanda is very ill? Fanny asked.
Sophie shrugged.
She's been exposed to the disease over and over by those she sought to help. I fear she's gravely ill.
I can't bear it. The very thought of losing her is more than I can endure. It's bad enough when you expect the death of an older person. I still miss our grandparents terribly.
I miss my mother, Sophie whispered. Especially now that I have Elizabeth.
Fanny took hold of her hand.
Of course you do.
My sisters have never been as dear to me as you and Amanda, Sophie continued, tears in her eyes. I wish we could be at her side to nurse her.
She squeezed Fanny's hand.
I'd just feel better to be near and see for myself that everything possible was being done.
Or to tell her how much we love her.
Sophie met Fanny's damp eyes.
You do suppose she knows, don't you? I mean, we've often said as much to each other, haven't we?
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.